In the criminal justice system, internet-based offenses are considered especially heinous. In Des Moines, Iowa, the dedicated Diakonos who investigate these vicious crimes are members of an elite squad known as the Annual Conference Diakonos. These are their stories.
Dun, dun.
There has been a crime at Annual Conference. As you all know, there have been several cases of missing Wi-Fi.
Due to the severity and intensity of these happenings, a special Diakonos task force has been assigned to the case. We've just found out that the Wi-Fi is not missing, it's been stolen.
Dun dun!
Okay. The excellent Diakono investigators have come up with three theories of why the missing Wi-Fi has been stolen. Theory number one is that they've been looking under the tables to see if it's hidden there. Have you guys noticed us looking under the tables? Yeah, a little bit?
Good looking. Theory two is that the Wi-Fi signal has been overwhelmed by the delegates playing solitaire online.
Hello, I'm Detective Murphy, and these are my partners, Cook and Fernandez. We've been investigating this case and have several theories. Our most convincing theory is that there is a solitaire overload to the system.
Too many people have been playing online solitaire, and it's such as these people, and it's making our systems and crash.
I went undercover to interview an individual who is playing solitaire to see if I could get more insight on the solitaire to Wi-Fi connection. But the person said I was being diakonoing. We've also had a special agent going around with an antenna in her arm looking for a Wi-Fi connection just like this.
Sounds good.
I didn't know that was in there.
The sad part about this is that some of our closest friends are part of this online solitaire playing, such as Emily Lee Simpson at table 27.
If you think that's bad, it's rumored that even our own Bishop Trimble and his board are playing solitaire on the big screen behind them, before and after annual conference. And while you guys are voting, he's using the iPad to play.
We have an iPad at table 126.
Yes, dispatch, yes, we have a possible hack with an iPad, table 126. Please send out one unit.
There he is.
Yes.
Get him.
Get him. Get him.
Get him.
Get him.
Another group that, ooh.
Yeah, you can get
take him away.
I absolutely love
him. Lock him up. America's finest right there.
Another group that we've caught is our very own technology and camera crew. They've been playing online solitaire right under our noses.
Uh-oh.
Now remember, these are pure theory, and we still need to investigate to find out more evidence. But hackers beware, watch out, we're getting closer.
But we are still asking that you stop playing solitaire and other games such as Angry Birds or Words with Friends. Instead, write more notes so that we can further our investigation. Thank you.
Dun dun.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The third theory of the missing Wi-Fi is that the knitting needles that people have been using is acting as makeshift antennas.
Okay, so while we were discussing the investigation, we assumed the knitting needles interfered with the Wi-Fi.
We'd like to, all you gorgeous knitters out there, we need to ask you to please stop knitting. so we don't have a magnetic field and so we can get the internet back up. And by the way, for all you non-science geeks out there, a magnetic field is a region in space where a magnet or an object of magnetic material will interfere with a non-contact of a magnetic force.
Well, I guess the technology should have been better by now.
Maybe we should stop knitting.
Wait, sorry for the inconvenience, but I was just told by other investigators that our theory was wrong and there is a new one. So you may continue knitting.
Dun dun.
During our investigation, we have found one hot spot, a small place where Wi-Fi can be reached.
It's about the size of a baseball, and it's over in that corner back there somewhere. So feel free to get cozy and try to get internet.
We are sorry to say that we've reached a dead end in our investigation, but
let's Congo.
What's up?
You guys are great. Looking good.
Oh, look at that.
Yeah.
Feel free to join in if you want.
Yeah. Where's Benji? I don't even see him.
Who is this strange character coming up here?
Who is this?
Who are you?
Keep going. Just wait for him.
What?
Do you guys see this?
What's going on?
Who is that?
Meanwhile, in the investigation, someone is stealing the Wi-Fi.
Stop that!
Stop
man!
That man! Get him!
Stop him!
Go get him, guys! You're doing great! Alright, our guess, this is as far as our investigation's gotten us. Oh no, there's. Oh, look out!
Don't worry, we'll catch him.
Is this to be continued?
But anyway, tune in next week to our Law and Order, and we will hopefully have figured out the
case of the missing
Wi-Fi. Case of the missing Wi-Fi.
Case of the missing Wi-Fi.
To be continued.
Dun dun.
Dun dun.
Dun dun.
What do you want
us to
say? Bishop, brothers and sisters in Christ. My name is Steve Braudts, and I am the director of Diakonos, the annual conference program on leadership development for youth and young adults. You may have noticed that we changed the name this year to better reflect what we believe is their new role and what they're doing. They're no longer being just pages, but they're being servants to all of you. Our scripture that we chose comes from Mark chapter 9, verse 35. And he says, he sat down and called the 12 and said to them, whoever wants to be first must be last of all and diakonos of all, servant of all. Then he took a youth and he put him among them. And taking that youth in his arms, he said to them, whoever becomes one such as this youth in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me. This program that we've been continuing for 3 years now, and now called Diakonos, is to allow our youth and young adults to learn what it means to truly embrace the five vows of membership in the United Methodist Church. These last 4 days, they have been practicing and living as an Acts 2 community church. They have lived together, they have commuted together, they have communed together, they have worshiped together, they have prayed together, and they have lived together as one. And as they came together and took upon these vows, the first of which was presence. And Grayson's going to share with us now.
Oh, you're supposed to be up there. Oh, sorry. Yeah, I know. I got confused. How's it going? I'm Grayson McElroy. I'm 19, and I'm from Algona, and I'm a diakonos, or a diakonai. Yeah, okay. All right. Well, since Steve has asked me and a few others to give our testimonies on our experiences as pages. And, you know, you see, it's been 3 years since I was at my first annual conference. And, you see, before I came, I didn't know anything about it, except that my mom and dad came to it to take care of church business. And ever since I was of age, my parents have wanted me to be a page. And every once a year, at whenever it was when the pages stuff came out, they always asked me if I wanted to do it. And I said no, because I wasn't interested, and that was the end of the discussion. And so after living in Lamoni for 6 years, my family and I moved to Algona. My parents told me I was going to page at annual conference, and I didn't have a choice. I honestly had no idea what to expect when I first arrived at Hilton Coliseum in June of 2009, but I was happily surprised by how much I enjoyed it, and I couldn't wait to come back and be able to do it all again with the friends that I had made. And by the way, I'm now finishing up my fourth year as a page, or diakonoi, sorry. Okay. But, you see, in my 4 years as a page, I've learned a lot of things about myself and how I want people to remember me. And I found that the most important thing that I can do is to try to make a difference in people's lives. And, you see, I've met a lot of kids in the last few years at conference. And there were certain ones that, you know, for some reason or another, they trusted me enough to open up about the issues that they were dealing with personally at home. And, you know, they've dealt with everything from different forms of abuse, self-mutilation, suicidal thoughts, and broken families. And I've met someone like this every year. But you see, most of them don't know that each year after conference ended, I went out of my way to help these people, whether it was contacting their parents or even their local pastors to see if I could help them in some way or another. And I can honestly say now that every one of those individuals are in a good place now and not in harm's way. But switching gears here, and don't worry, it's all connected, don't worry. You see, my favorite movie character of all time, hands down, is Ferris Bueller. And for those of you who haven't seen Ferris Bueller's Day Off, it's about Ferris Bueller who skips a day of school with his girlfriend and his best friend, and they head to the city of Chicago for a day of fun that they won't ever forget. And in my opinion, Ferris is about the coolest character of all, not because, you know, he's kind of a rebel, and no, it's not because he skipped school, and he's the coolest guy because he's an innovator, and he influenced everyone around him to be the best that they could be. And, you know, whether it was his best friend, Cameron, who finally stood up for himself against his overbearing parents, or a drugged-up Charlie Sheen in a police station, Ferris Bueller influenced them to be the best person they could be, and in turn, they tried to influence others to be the best they could be. And I found that, like Ferris, I like to see my friends and people that I know at their best. And that's what paging has done for me. In one way or another, it has given me the opportunity to influence others to be the best that they can be. Thank you.
Grayson has been an example of what it means to be present and presence in the church, in the community, with his friends, and his family. And part of that comes from his experience here with you at annual conference. The second gift or second vow that we take as Methodists that I've been pushing with these young people is prayer. Everything we do is wrapped in prayer, from praying at the restaurants that we eat, to beginning the days, to ending the days, to asking for prayer requests, and wrapping everything we do in prayer. And now I'd like to ask Diana to come and share her testimony.
Hey guys, my name is Diana Dovenspike. Whew, I'm really nervous. I'm not really good at public speaking, but here goes. I'm 16 years old, and I attend First United Methodist Church in Indianola. This is my third year of paging, and I love it. It's the best thing about my summer, my year, pretty much. Not gonna lie to you, I had no idea what annual conference was until my mom came back from her first annual conference at Hilton Coliseum. And she just praised the pages for what they were doing. She loved their energy and how they were crazy with their skits. And she thought it was something I'd like to do. I didn't think much of it. She kind of pushed it on me, but I kind of blew her off. Sorry, Mom. My hearing was selective at the time, and I didn't really want to do it, so. But she pushed me again in March, so I decided to apply, if anything, just to please her. Sorry, I'm not trying to offend you. Love you, Mom. So I applied and I got in, and I prepared myself to meet new people, which is not my strong suit at the time. The first day was nerve-wracking, and I was much like this, shaking, trying to meet everyone, just be quiet, lay low. On that Sunday night, there was a tragic death in my community. A valued friend of everyone in Indianola committed suicide while under the influence of drugs. And without my pages, I would have never gotten through it. Sorry, I'm tearing up. Everyone was devastated. The worship that night consisted of me sobbing while everyone prayed for me. Thank you. And the rest of the week consisted of people giving me hugs constantly and long talks with people like Grayson, a 3-hour long talk, and others who really helped me through it. And I would never have been able to get through without my pages. Anyways, okay. The friends that I've made and experiences I've had here have changed my life. These 5 days of bonding, walking until our feet are screaming, ordering pizza at 12 a.m., napping in between legislative sessions, epic water balloon fights, and about 4 hours of sleep per night are like the highlight of my summer. This leadership program has made me a leader. The once shy 14-year-old girl now standing before you would never have gotten up in front of a group of 20, let alone a group of 2,000. And because of this program, I am ready to take roles of leadership I never would have thought possible. Thank you for your time and all the notes. And all the candies that you guys leave on the tables for us, those are really great too. And all God's people said,
amen.
Always wanted to do that.
As we wrapped Diana in prayer 3 years ago, that was my first solo time as the director of this group of people, and I wasn't quite sure what I was getting myself into. But it became quite evident as we looked at the continued vows that they were portraying and doing, and as they got to gifts, this group of youth bring a group of gifts that are unmatched anywhere in our church. They have all that is needed and all that is desired to grow and to build this church into the new century ahead of us. One of our future leaders in their local church is Benji, the young man who stole the Wi-Fi, and
All right. Hey, everyone. I'm Benji Lewis, and this is my fourth year paging. And a highlight of my year, annual conference, has become one of the most important parts of my life. Between the strong spiritual presence, the lasting friendships, and the enthusiasm for faith sharing, the Diakonos are the greatest spiritual opportunity for youthful Methodists. Without this wonderful program, my walk in faith would be unkindled, there'd be a lot less guidance to it, and it would be extremely uninspired as compared to what being with this group and other groups in the past has done for me. And my found enthusiasm for the church that has grown from being forced to go to Sunday school by my parents has now expanded to being a member of some committees at my church and serving both in the office and with the maintenance of the church. And again, coming to annual conference, it is one of the, as I said, the highlights of my year. And this group of other diakonos, I couldn't ask for a better group, both in or out of my spiritual life.
Part of what we do throughout this time from Friday until this afternoon is that they practice the vows of membership, they explore, they worship, they do hospitality, they do all the things necessary to learn and to grow. It's part of the leadership, it's part of what I believe is necessary for the continued growth and evangelism of the church. This past week, it was amazing. Almost all of these youth in their entire time had never been to the conference center. They had never witnessed our presence at the end of the runway. They had never seen the great presence of artwork, of historical data, of the chapel, the bishop's office, the cabinet room. And so this year, as part of their off time on Saturday night, they went to the conference center and they explored. They didn't open any desks, Bishop, I promise you. But they were amazed at the fact that we have a presence that they did not know about. And they were in service. They've been in service to you, waiting on you, delivering your notes. But they're also in service in other ways. In their gifts. You may notice that they're wearing the purple t-shirts today. And they've been wearing a different colored shirt. Well, they don't take those shirts home. That's not theirs. They have now donated those to Bidwell Riverside to be reused and to be given out to those of more need. Not only do they do that, but the offering that you've been taking for them, they will be tithing and giving an offering of that back to those who need it. And they'll be announcing that later on this afternoon. But these young people demonstrate everything. And now Chrissy has a word about serving.
Good morning, everyone. This is my second year of paging. I got into this because my deacon at my church, Brenda Hobson, you all should know her. She's up here all the time. Table 87, if you want to write her a note that we can pass for you. She gave me the paperwork. I filled it out and ended up coming last year. I had really no idea what it was. I just filled out the paperwork and handed it in. And I had no idea what I was getting myself into. It seems to happen to me a lot, but I just say yes and hope for the best. Conference has showed me that teenagers like me can come and join in fellowship and service together, all being Christians and still having fun. We are doing hard work. I mean, my feet hurt right now standing up in front of you guys from walking all this time. And I've gotten about like 10 hours of sleep in the past 2 days. But we're still having fun out here and with our skit and just like being in fellowship and being with together, it's so much fun. And it has encouraged me to be more involved in my own church and in community. I try to get involved and donate as much of my time as I can through the church. I'm excited and I feel blessed that I have gotten the chance to be with these people and be a part of this conference. And one thing I say before I go is I would like to say how awesome Steve is. He's just great. I'm so glad he is here to lead us. He's such a great leader. He always knows what to say and always asks the right questions to get us thinking. He is such a great role model, and we would like to say thanks for this awesome man. And also, he did these shirts. I mean, come on, these are awesome. He's a great artist, too, so that's pretty awesome of him, too. Thank you, Steve.
As their act of service, I'd ask Chrissy and Grayson and Diana, if they would take these t-shirts, two full boxes, and deliver them to table 246, please. Right here. As they deliver these t-shirts, you may have noticed that fifth vow of membership that was just added, and I believe was added timely with the starting of the Diakonos ministry, and that was witness. Part of what we talk about is the fact that each of these youth need to learn how to give their testimony, how to give their witness, how to be an example to the other youth. The other thing you may have noticed is that somebody in their family, in their church, was a witness to them and handed them the paperwork. When we first got here on Saturday, I had numerous people come up to me and say, "You have way too many diakonos here." And I said, "We don't have enough of them here." Can you imagine what your local church would be like if we trained all of your youth to stand at the doorways and give high fives and group hugs to everybody that entered your church? If the youth of your church could be the examples of giving tithing and giving offerings, to giving the shirts off their backs, of being able to stand up and give their witness and their testimony to those around them, our churches will grow. So I'm encouraging each of you to find that paperwork next March, hand it to your youth, encourage them, parents, force them if you have to. Because there is always, I have never turned away a youth yet. It has been amazing that God always selects the right ones to show up at the right time. That even when more than 32 apply, something comes up and the number dwindles down, but we end up with 32 of them, and they're the ones that need to be here, that need to learn, and they continue to grow, and they continue to graduate until they get to the point that they are your witnesses, they are your servants, they are your diakonai in order to grow this church. And so at this time, Bishop, we would like to, as we normally do, we have a t-shirt for you, because you are the lead diakonos, or the diakonoi, as they've been referred to. So, Bishop, we would like to give you this t-shirt so that you may join us as part of this group. And I want to thank you for your continued kindness. And like I said, send me more of them. We'll get them trained up. Amen? I did forget two people. We have Kendi here and Chuck. Where's Chuck at? Is he up there? Chuck, get over here. These are the two adults that have helped me get through the night. Most of them talked about the fact that they got 10 hours of sleep. Well, I'm a little jealous because I know that that's more sleep than I've gotten since Friday night, but I couldn't do it without two more sets of eyes, two more sets of ears, two more sets of arms and voices and witnesses in order to continue to allow them to know that God loves them and that you love them. So Chuck, come on up here so we can get a picture.